Yeah.
Welcome on in, GripTV Nation. Welcome to another GripTV Hangout. It's going to be a special one today. I'm joined with Man Cave Racing TV, Jay Plays, Air Messi. My name's Matt Malone. You know me as Showdown 1983. And guess what, guys? A special announcement. A brand new member to the GripTV team. It's none other than Quirkatize. There he is, Tyson. Ooh. What's up, man? How the hell are you? Hey, how is everybody? We're just going to be hanging out here today.
I'm good. Thank you.
Everybody
good? I appreciate it.
We're going to be taking your live questions at hashtag GripTVLive on Twitter and at GripTVLive on Twitter. Feel free to ask some questions into the live chat as well. Oh boy, let's get it going. Let's meet our new member, Quirkatized. How the hell are you? Tell us a little bit about yourself, and how you got into the sim racing community.
Well, let's see where to start. I guess we could start with Dirt Rally, since that's where mostly a lot of my streamers or viewers know me from. And just started with Dirt Rally in early access April of last year, and then started streaming it on a regular basis around probably August of last year. And then just took off from there. Have about 11 or 1200 hours in it.
Holy cow.
Usually I had a top 10 on about every stage with every class. Since they did a leaderboard reset, I was pushing again, and I'm about halfway done, cuz it's 720 stages to do it all. Ooh. With every single class and every single stage. But a lot of people probably watch for the heel toe. It's a bit boring in iRacing with the pedal cam, but in rally, it's a lot of fun. It's because you gotta be like a ballerina with your footwork.
Yeah, we're just watching a little bit of that action. You got like three separate cameras then, I guess, for the stream then, right?
Yeah.
Plus the green screen.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
But that's now awesome. you're iRacing. How is that transition? Yeah.
It didn't transition that well at first. I'm so used to trying to, flick the car with the brakes and transfer the weight. And it was good for drifting, but it wasn't good for racing.
I said, it's like, I was watching him do dirt, man. And he was like, I'm so glad you shit that iRacing. I said, because if you were this good in iRacing as you are in dirt, I would be freaking devastated. And he's like, oh, so I shit that iRacing. I was like, well, no, not really. Yeah, right, I am.
Yeah, it translated okay. It took me a while to get used to circuit racing again. I hadn't done much multiplayer. I did a lot of single-player sim racing previously all the other years with R-Factor and Live for Speed and the GTR series and then Race 07. So I played a lot, pretty much all the sims, but I was more like the single-player career type of player. And then just kind of took off in multiplayer with iRacing. I mean, nothing really compares to it for multiplayer, so...
Yeah, Goli Harris says you must be excited for dirt in iRacing, huh?
yeah, I'm gonna give it a go. I'm not one for oval racing, at least not yet. But I'm definitely gonna get a dirt track and car and give it a go.
And Q2 chiming in on Twitter, Quirk won so many races because of me. At least someone listened to me, Resident Sleeper.
Yeah, he's been my Kuti's been my race engineer, my fuel calculator the last few times. The last race that I just did with Kutu telling me what to pick for fuel, I questioned it. But everybody else in chat was like, don't question Kutu.
No, don't question Kutu. You'd be banned for life.
And I finished with a tenth of a gallon left after I crossed the finish line.
Wow. Wow. So what's your go-to series in iRacing? I seen you in Renault race, but what do you usually typically go to?
Yeah, Formula Renault is probably my best right now that I've gotten comfortable with that car. And any track that it's on, I'm really enjoying it.
It's a lot of fun.
Besides the Formula Renault, I suppose it would be GT3. That's always exciting.
Yeah, yeah.
For various reasons.
How about any HPD races coming up?
Let's not talk about the HPD races, JP. But yeah, I like Proto GT as well. And for those in chat that are wondering why JP brought that up, I don't know, should I talk about that now? Or
here it is, the nation's all ears.
Okay. So if you guys are ever in my chat and wondering why, I mean, probably half the viewers know what's going on, but
thank you.
Yeah, so I was doing an HPD race, and I was unaware of DRS, and I don't know anything about half these cars. And yeah, he's like, JP told me to hit the DRS because I was in Road Atlanta, and I was wondering why all the other HPDs were going by me like I was standing still. Tim Bertie, he was in there, and I remember he just went by me and like gained 5 seconds just on the back straight.
Oh, he is very, very, very fast.
Yeah. I was using the default high downforce setup, so I had no top speed at all.
Oh, my gosh.
And I even pitted and went into the key bindings and binded my DRS.
Classic. That's all that newfangled technology. It's too much to keep up with.
And then I'm hitting it. I'm like, it's not working. Oh!
Learning experience, I guess, huh?
So yeah,
I was like an hour. I was like, I wasn't sure. Should I feel a little bit bad about that? But I think we had fun, everyone, about this.
Yeah. So JP did a GT3 race today. So I'm pretty sure that the McLaren is OP at Monza. Is that the consensus? Everyone's in the McLaren.
Yeah. I really did not see any other cars in there. I think I saw a single BMW in there when I was lapping it, but I think in the starting grid, I was starting from ninth place. I think there was one Audi in front of me, but I couldn't see that anymore in the end of the race, so I think it got dropped too. But yeah, McLaren OP in there.
Yeah. So
the 224 last time because it was we just Maca Central everywhere.
Yeah. So it's the end of the season, guys. Oh my gosh. Week 12 is here. Week 13's coming. Oh my gosh.
I'm quite glad it's over in all of this.
Yeah, I know.
Because the GT3 one is. The GT3 schedule this season was absolutely shambolic. They've put some real crap stuff on there that just doesn't work well with GT3. I'm sure whoever decided this season was just basically trolling. Pretty sure of it. Well, we had Nord Shitlife again.
Well,
we had VIR again. Mid-Ohio. It's like...
That's tough, man.
You know, just I tell you what, let's just pick all the shit tracks for one whole season and just so everybody else gets pissed off with it. It just had done my head in.
Well, here you go, Air Messi. We got the schedule for next season's GT3. And you see what's very first is the Nord Shitlife, as you would say. First week.
Do you know what? I've honestly not looked because it's annoyed me. So we got Road Atlanta. Road America had a shocker at as well this season. Donington finally, thank God for that.
Yeah.
Oh, Donington. Bathurst, yes.
Bathurst, we got week four.
Oh, Bathurst is good.
Zolder.
And there it is. Le Mans, week six. There you go. Brand new track to iRacing. Good to see Road America on there, though.
I'm so going to learn that. Oh, Road America again. God damn it.
We've got Cirque de la South.
Well, we had Road America this season. We also had Suzuka, and they're in again, and Nord Shitlife's in again. It's we got that many tracks in the game. Why can't they just cycle through them all? I know they do have the favorites, but yeah, I don't know. It just seems to be they pick the ones that I don't like. I'm sure just somebody's there, sort of, I don't know, finding out which ones I don't like and saying, yes, we'll do that.
Yeah, and here it is, dude. I'm telling you, this is the track we've been waiting for. At least I have. 6-7 wide Mazdas on the straightaway drag racing. So we'll show some of the video from iRacing, work in progress. But we're getting this in it's less than a week, right? Or a week and a half or something?
I was talking in my stream today that when the Le Mans is going to be released, I think Matt is going to take the MX-5s in there and host a ton of shit races in there.
Yes. We may even get to sixth gear with major draft and bump drafting.
You have to do some kind of a conga line in there.
Slowstis versus Mazda conga line.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
And then throwing
without the chicanes as well?
Oh, that's a good point. I wonder what configurations they're going to have.
Well, they'll have the chicanes in and the mount. They're not doing the Bugatti circuit, apparently, which is the small version.
Okay, really?
Yeah, apparently there was trucks parked all over it or something. So from what I know, they're not doing the Bugatti circuit, which is when you take turn the left and the right, you would normally turn right again. That's the Bugatti circuit. So, and then you go for the normal one. You go straight on and left to do the full. But the Bugatti circuit will probably end up in the Mazdas and stuff like that.
Dude, this is gonna be epic, man! And checking their release notes because they have release notes all set up. They're having a special aero package for the GT3 cars just for this track.
Oh, and they've done it on a lot of them, haven't they?
Yeah.
Well, you guys know what car to pick. McLaren.
Yeah. You know, if I was going to be the main car.
I hope they do something with that to stop that just being so ridiculously fast in a straight compared to everything else.
GT1 cars are getting specific aero packages. Those are going to be fast. So
I think they're gonna do the balancing for GT3 cars after the championship season is over. I don't think they're there to touch the cars at the moment because it would change them a lot. And I think what they were talking about before the next season is that they would be bringing out the new tire model iteration version 7 for this season. But I think that's the same reason why they did not bring it yet, because it would change the balance quite a lot for the GT3.
Okay, because the only thing I see in the release notes for the GT3 cars are just season setups have been updated. So it doesn't sound like any crazy BOP updates to try to balance more. So you're probably right, they'll probably wait. Because that's usually always something they put in there. Try to twerk it here and there. Twerk it? Tweak it here and there.
Tweak it.
Oh, man. Twerk it.
So we know what Matt's been doing.
He's been watching some Miley Cyrus.
Yes, I have. Don't look at my YouTube history, please. Oh, my
instantly
gosh.
Checks Matt's YouTube history.
Yeah. So this.
Also,
yes?
They were talking about some kind of surprise. The update notes.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And it's any speculations on that? Do you want to speculate on that?
It's not going to be fucked this time.
I heard it was the LMP1 car. Is that? It's one of those fast spaceship cars. Is that? It's for Le Mans.
Man, that'd be so nice.
And I heard that they're waiting for the go ahead.
I think something that big, they would have at least said that they've got the licensing or something.
I said that
when they were doing the laser scan for the Le Mans, I thought that it would be quite they should have done something else than just scanning the track, because there was the World Endurance Championship race going on at the same time. So I would think they may have scanned something else than the track too, but I don't know. Don't know about that.
And then for... what do you get?
I just reading that now, and it's like, Why would they bring it in on the first week? Normally, like when they bring something out, gets dropped in week 13. So I think it's going to be, it's probably just going to be announcement of something coming. I think rather than like something solid to touch.
Like the fireworks, dude. Remember the last update? We had fireworks. That was pretty cool, dude. I have to say, they're exciting.
I think we're gonna get some flyovers now.
Oh, okay. Yeah, they put that in, haven't they? The jet fighters flying over Le Mans. That's in the patch notes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, that'll be good. We've already had plans in iRacing, because there's one on Daytona that just keeps landing.
Oh, yeah.
Never see him take off, but he always lands.
Yeah.
And Donington as well. It's always coming into land every time.
Busy airport, that.
We actually know somebody with a beta thingy account, so I'm wondering if we could probably maybe ask said person if he knows.
So we'll have to, but he's not allowed to see it.
Yeah, but doesn't matter. We'll have to tap him up on the quiet, see if we can get some inside info.
So JP, you want to run down the new NVIDIA stuff they get? DirectX 11 NVIDIA stuff?
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, I was quite excited about that when I was running through the update notes on Friday's stream. I was like casually going skimming through the update notes until we got to the DX11 point in there. I was reading the first words in there. I was like, oh my god, SMP coming up. So it's the simultaneous multi-projection, if I pronounce it right. It's the new technology for the Pascal generation GTX cards from NVIDIA. And basically what it does is that it does the three screen rendering separately, what iRacing is doing now, but instead of doing through the iRacing software, it is doing through the NVIDIA hardware driver. So that's basically translating that if you are running on triples and you use the SMP instead of rendering the triples through the iRacing, it should give you a lot better performance boost. And there's a very good video on the YouTube explaining the SMP, where they even demonstrated how it will correct the side screens if you have like an angled side screen. So,
and that's only awesome for the 1000 series.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
It should be like your middle monitor as far as the image quality is, but on your sides, right? It won't be stretched anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what's supposed to be.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
I remember
what you're
when
saying.
We covered this when they came out, that we covered this thing, and we showed the little video as well, and basically. From when NVIDIA announced it, because like all other games, if you play it with on triple monitors, it just stretches out, just gives you the full flat image, doesn't it? Well, what it is, inside the driver, you put your dimensions, your monitors, same as you do with iRacing, you put the dimensions of monitors in, you put the degrees in, and then basically you click a button and it'll give you the exact peripheral vision that you should get in every single game.
Wow.
Yeah.
So basically, iRacing put that into iRacing, so now the card handles that, rather than iRacing handle it, so you should get a much, much better performance out of it, which will help me a great deal, actually, because I've had to turn mine off, because otherwise my frames just get dumped when I stream.
Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Just got to get a Series 10 card first.
It's exciting. Oh, yeah. And any news on, like, a 1080 Ti that they're coming out with? I haven't heard.
Matt, you have to get a Titan X.
Okay.
1200.
Okay. Yeah. Easy.
Just get two of them. Run them SLI.
Okay.
It's fine. Somebody want to sell their kidneys?
I'm gonna have to like hook up a generator, like to run
$1,200 for one card.
That's crazy.
You can mine bitcoins with that. So.
Is that still a thing? Hey, look what else they have. Animation. Now the wind will now procedurally animate the flags on some tracks. So we get flag waving now.
Yeah.
So you don't even have to look in the info to see where the wind is blowing. You'll know. Actually, that helps because I'm always so damn confused. It'll say, like, wind north, 12 miles an hour. Now, is it coming out of the north or is it blowing towards the north? And which way is north? I don't know which way the track is situated, geographically speaking. So I don't even know if am I getting a tailwind going down the straight? Am I getting it in my face? It's so hard to freaking know. You got to like go to Google Earth, and I still don't even understand how it works. Well, but
it doesn't matter much in a Mazda anyway, man.
I heard in the patch notes that they're going to add one of those little dash globes that has a compass in it.
I actually wish they would.
And a bobbly head as well.
Yes.
There was something as well, wasn't it, where they animated the pit crew more now or something, people behind the pit crew or something. They're animated now as well as with a new model.
Yeah, I know the lollipop guy still stands like this. He's like... He just got his arms out. It's like, thanks, Jesus. So, you know.
I think we get the new model for the drivers now.
The head positioning modeling? Yeah. Dude, is that going to screw up everyone's view? Like, is everyone going to have to go in and adjust their view now of their camera? Will it actually move the camera in the car based on head position? Is that what it's talking about?
I think it said something about people who've got custom setups already. They might have to move them, I think, when I quickly read it anyway. I'm not sure.
Oh, great. Yeah, let's see if I can find that on here. Yeah, head positioning. I know it's in the.
I wonder with the new character model, can we already see the hands going like more than 90 degrees? It has been like 2 or 3 years when they're like, stop there. When you're like turning yourself like this and the animated hands are like at this position only.
They don't know how to cross yet.
Yeah.
Paul's just giving me an idea. When we were on about like their super secret thing that's going to come in, well, he said that they put extra pit men in the pit crew, but they don't do anything. Remember what they said they were working on a while ago?
Animated pit crew? Yes. And the lollipop guy was just like the introduction to that.
Maybe that's what they're dropping. I don't understand how they're ever going to get that to work, though.
Look at this. Because I don't know.
You know, you've got to stop right in the right place in your pit box. If you don't, what happens if you go reverse till you get in the right place? Or do they shuffle forward and back? What happens if you're not perfectly straight? Are some people going to be clipped inside the car changing the wheel?
I'm sure. Probably.
But it'd be nice if that is the thing.
Yeah. Yeah, it says all vehicle seatbelts now change color to match driver selections. Yes, dude. I've been wanting this for years.
And you can paint them.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
You can also kind of stuff paint your...
Zach's going to have SpongeBob SquarePants bloody things. Seatbelts.
But you still can't paint the wheels on a Slosters. But you can paint your seatbelts. Something wrong there.
So is it going to be an extra file? Like a paint file that Trading Paint's going to have new seatbelt files?
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Hopefully they don't delete the old paints when they're adding new stuff in the Trading Paints.
Oh, look at this. You can have a hotkey now that'll turn off and on the virtual mirror while driving. Because that's super necessary.
Some people are really anal hardcore about that, though. They don't want it there.
Yeah, Steven DeBoer has a Formula Renault league that you have to have the virtual mirror off. And the league is going great. What else we got?
With it off, and for streaming, it's nice for the viewers, you know? Even if you don't want to use it, because then they can see what's going on.
Okay.
I'd be screwed without mine, in all honesty. I would be absolutely screwed. Like, because I have, like, a really high field of view on mine, so I can even see... Well, I can't... The trouble is the high field of view is, like, where people are quite close to you, they're really, really small, and then all of a sudden it's like they become very, very big really, really quickly, and then bump you dead.
You can change it.
You change it to 30 degrees, and it's roughly the same as the in-car mirror, which is what mine set out, and mine looks pretty much one-to-one.
I don't like that, though, because it helps when you're passing or you're getting overtaken. You can see if somebody's dived up the inside or outside. It just gives you a lot more view.
I like mine one-to-one, I must admit. I've had it like that for years.
I agree with Man Cave. I'd rather have it look more realistic than, like, it's almost like a fisheye lens where you can barely see the guy in your virtual mirror, but he's right on your ass. It's like, well, you don't get a sense of spacing behind you, in my opinion. I think I have mine set to, like, 60, which...
30's pretty much one in the GT3 cars. 30's pretty much one-to-one.
Okay.
With your normal mirrors that's on the car. So, and it's the lowest you can get it as well. So
yeah, it's worth messing around with.
I messed around with it for a long time when I first started, because I got sick of, like, when you look at the in-car mirror compared to the virtual mirror, the miles behind, and then you look at the relative and the right on your backside. So
exactly. Yeah.
It's like, no, get that changed, and I want it exactly how it is.
Yeah.
And then at least I know where it is. But it works for me. It's what I've always done.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, I'm at the back, so I've only got to worry about the leaders coming through.
Oh, boy.
I've only got to worry about blue flags.
Yes.
Looks like the Formula Renault's getting nerfed.
Yeah.
Because it could take so much damage right now.
Right.
But now it's taken less, or it's going to, unless I'm reading that incorrectly.
No, that's yeah, because right now it's kind of a tank, but it looks like, yeah, they're going to do it so where it's going to take more impact, I guess. Let's see. Less capable of sustaining large impacts without suffering permanent damage. Oh, boy.
I don't understand the next line. Fixed bug that was causing the brake bias knob on the opponent cars to continually rotate. Can you like...
Who the hell's seen that?
I don't know about that.
Well, I reckon that's someone obviously with VR. They've been looking at it and they're just like...
Well, it's probably in a replay, right? I mean, who finds that while they're driving?
Yeah.
Right? Unless they have that black box open, I don't know.
Definitely not me.
So, am I the only one that's... Oh, I know. I say that. I don't think Tyson has as well. Am I the only one that's tried F1, the new one?
Oh, yeah. Let's talk about F1 2016.
Oh.
I've not tried it. John, what are your thoughts, man?
I like it. They've actually done a really good job this time. And anybody who knows me knows that I've been nothing but slating them for years, because it seemed to be they just got worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. But this one's actually really good. The career mode is excellent. You got 10 seasons. I'm not really interested in doing 10 seasons, but there's a 10 season now. And in the practice sessions, you get given 3 objectives, which you can do in any practice session. And one of them is entry points, apexes, and exit points, the corners. You got a little box. And that's really nice. And when you've got to get all them right, and it gives you so many points, then you can put into research and development. The second one then is it's the one you've got to manage your tires. You've got to get under a certain time and manage your tires. And the third one then is like basically your qualifying time. You've got to put a qualifying run in, and if you get them all right, you get points then to upgrade. And the upgrade system's quite big. It's like 5 or 6 different categories, and then it's like, I don't know, 5 or 6 upgrades for each one, so you feel like you're much more involved in what you're doing with the car and all that sort of stuff. So you can, in all honesty, start in a real shit car, and as long as you hit everything right, you can upgrade it to be one of the best cars by the end of a season. It's quite good.
Yeah, so I like it a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, you've tried it.
I was just gonna say I have like 30 hours or so in it, so not a whole lot, but most of it's at the first race in Australia, because I keep redoing the career, and the AI is a bit of a bitch, but that's okay.
You just tweaked that again, I think.
Yeah. But mostly it's a good balance between simulation and arcade, I think. It's a really good pick-up-and-go racing game. And I think they did a good job with it. The career has good depth to it, and there's DRS, so that's good.
Yeah. What I've noticed is that, is there a true cockpit view? Because every time I see somebody playing or videos of it, it's like over the top.
There is. Yeah.
Okay.
And there's also outside the car.
There's a lot of adjustments you can do. For your cockpit view or all your views, you can go up and down, forward and back, and you can even, I think you can even adjust the angle, the tilt of the cockpit. So
They've actually put it into the game now, in the options, rather than you having to get somebody to mess about with all the text files and stuff. So that's kind of nice. And you got the safety cars back again. You got formation laps, which are kind of cool. Manual starts, which basically consist of your clutches, your change-up buttons. You just got to hold it in, get a right rev range, then release it upon green. Nice little touch. Multiplayer, is it up to 22, I think. Up to 22 people can play in a multiplayer career. So you can go right from the very first race to the very end of the season, with a bunch of friends, which is kind of cool.
And it has rain.
Oh, man, that rain is killer. Like, the thing with this game is, like, it can be very easy, right? Well, not very easy, but very pick-up-and-play enjoyable. You can put, like, ABS on, you can put traction control on full, and, turn damage off, and it's a good pick-up-and-play. It doesn't matter what your skill level is. You can get on with it, and it's nice and easy. But then you can turn ABS off, and you can turn traction control off, and I tell you what, even in the dry with no traction control, those cars light up them rear wheels like that. It's a real struggle. You put it in the rain as well, and it's like fudging hell. It's properly difficult. It's good fun, though.
Have you tested out the comparison between the F1 2016 McLaren and the iRacing McLaren?
No,
Formula 1 cars.
I haven't, but I've seen that. Who was it? Oh, crap. GT Ross, is it them? The Spanish guys used to have said they did a video on that somewhere. I remember seeing it. I didn't watch it all though. But there is one out already done with that.
Well, I did a quick test at when I did the hour and a half endurance, or if you want to call it that, F1 race at Monza and in iRacing, and I think my best lap was like a 1:28. And, I'm not that fast in that car, or any car, but especially that car. And anyway, I wanted just to test it out of curiosity's sake, because I used basically the baseline setup in the F1 car in iRacing. And it was a 1:28 fastest lap. Most of the time it was around 1:30. And then I hopped into F1 2016 with no aids on and did like a 24 or 25. So... it's easier to drive, but it still has the challenge to it, F1 2016, where you do have to be careful with the throttle, but even with all the aids off, like, you can just slam on the brakes, and once you're, a little over, it's pretty good.
Yeah, we're just watching the comparison there from both games. There's differences, but man... I'm pretty surprised on how good F1 2016 looks, like the track itself.
It's unbelievably pretty.
Yeah, it
and
really
the
is.
Rain as well is spectacular. Like the puddles on the surface, it is just a beautiful looking game again. That's one thing they normally do quite well, man. Except for last year's, that looked like shit for some reason. But they normally do make a pretty game.
Yeah,
to be fair. I'd say the biggest downside to that game is it's hard to imagine a game coming out this far along in VR not supporting it.
Yeah.
It doesn't support VR, which is kind of strange because Dirt Rally does, and I don't know if they're using a new engine or what, but the 2015 F1 didn't support track IR, and this one doesn't support track IR or VR. So that's interesting.
Would that be able to be implemented with, like, a patch or anything? Is that something they can do that with?
I'm not they always, sure.
They always said, given that they're going to start releasing the games earlier now, I think there was, like, was it this season, I think, is the one they've released the earliest, is that they can do it early. The idea is they want to get it out, like, right at the beginning of the season. So in that aspect, it's a bit late. But, given the current technology and things like that, they can still add or take away and update and all that sort of stuff as they go along if things change. So, I don't know.
Talking about VR support, iRacing is actually getting an open VR support in the next build too. So you can actually, if you have HTC Vive, you can use that in the iRacing now. And I think through the open VR support, you can use other VR headsets too now in the future, starting from next week. So
they got Vive in there now, haven't they? So that means I could like nick my wife's phone and use that.
I don't know.
Yeah, it's cool to see iRacing get on board with that. It makes a lot of sense, you know?
Yeah.
I really don't want to get into IR, though, because I know the do that, like, if I do, then it's just going to mean that I'll have to stop streaming, because most VR streams look terrible. And, you know, it'll be, so which one do you want to do? Do you want to have the VR? Do you want to have the quality for people looking? So,
right.
So I'm just keeping away from it.
It's also harder on the streamer, because you'll have to use text-to-speech bot for your chat. And then, you know, you can't
with this
look
community.
At chat. If you, and you can't, if you miss what it says, you can't look at the chat, you know?
Right.
So it's harder to interact.
Yeah. I think Craig Parks did it the other, I was talking to him the other night, actually, Boxer Slab, and he was saying he did it, and there was only about 10 people in his chat, and he got trolled to fuck for like a couple
of months.
Yes. And it's all the regulars as well. That's the best part.
The
it's
robot
all the people
lady.
Trust.
Oh, man.
I'm looking at you, Aki.
So, right now I'm reviewing the new Fanatec CSL line of pedals and wheelbase and rim. And we're doing ongoing live reviewing on the stream. And so it's interesting. Fanatec has, it's like the different price point is what they're trying to meet. So for $650, you can get the Club Sport Lite bundle. And $650 for everything, when you consider the V2 base alone, is $600. So they pretty much slashed their price more than half, because if you figure, you know, you get the pedals as well. Yeah. But dude,
are you allowed to give your honest opinion? Or
yeah,
you have to
and I'm going to give it right now. These pedals, I've already swapped out. I got rid of the pedals. I'm done with the pedals. So I use the CSR Elites. And the brake load cell, there's an actual mechanical load cell. It's a device with an extra wire that goes into the little chipboard, right? With the CSL Elite pedals, it's just one wire. And they have a glorified tennis ball that is rubber spacers and like a hard sponge to give you the resistance for the brake. It's not an actual load cell. It's still based on movement of the pedal. It's just there's more resistance because of the spacers, right? So I'm just like, I'm thinking this is their replacement for the CSR Elites, because this is not an upgrade at all. You can't change the throw of the pedals. And you can't change the tension of, like, the pedals of, like, the throttle and the clutch. With the CSR Elites, you can at least change the there's a spring. And you can screw it down to make it more tension. And you can change the throw of each pedal. So, I don't understand. I mean, they look awesome. They're all murdered out, you know. They're all black and, you know. And it's just like, I don't understand. And they're $200 just for the pedals. The best thing the bundle's got going for it is the wheel base itself. And I did a little like first look review of like the pedals. We're showing the video now, but the base itself is $300. And I'd have to say that the base is actually pretty nice. I just put the Porsche rim onto the base. So I'm gonna try that today. I haven't tried it yet today. So we're gonna try that out. But we'll see, you know. But this is their light version of the CSW, so I don't know, man. It's interesting.
That's actually in the product page. It says that there is a load cell. It's a 90 kilogram load cell, which is integrated directly into the pedal arm and measures the pressure on the pedal arm itself. So basically, I think it's inside.
So it is a load cell then.
Yeah.
Yeah, good for you.
Dude, it's not a load cell, man. There's only one wire coming from it. I looked at it. I took it apart. It's literally just spacers and a piece of foam that's giving you resistance on the pedal. There's nothing else there. It's just a shaft with spacers on it. I'm telling
you. Could you see a pentometer then? Is there a pentometer in there?
No, there's nothing.
Right, well, how does it get it then?
It's a pedal. And then you push on it, and the more you push on it, the more resistance it gives you because of the spacers, right?
Yeah, but no, how does it pick up how hard you're, how far you're pressing it?
With a one wire, and it's based on how far you're pushing the pedal. And the more you push it...
The point is, it's either going to be a pedometer, right, which slides along a surface to tell the pedal how far the pedal's gone, or it's going to be some type of load cell that picks up how hard you're pressing it.
Yeah, it's so just it how far travel. The travel of the pedal is all that it's picking up. But you feel it, the more you push on it, there's more resistance because there's these rubber spacers in there that, you know, you can't push it all the way, obviously, because the rubber spacers are stopping it. It's like a glorified tennis ball. Literally. That's why so I'm
still probably better than the T3 APA Pro pedals anyway, because they're a fucking heap of shit.
So you're saying if you put a lot of pressure on it right away, but not fully depress it, it doesn't register it as like a hard press, like the V3 pedals? Because you can push a lot of pressure on that load cell and it'll, you know, register as a, I don't know if I'm saying it correctly. It'll peak up. Yeah.
No, I mean, it's literally just a shaft. It's just a regular pedal.
Okay.
The regular pedal, it's based on how far you push it, but then they put these rubber spacers on it and a piece of, like, hard foam to give you resistance. So the harder you push on it, you know, the more resistance you're going to get. But it's still just based on pedal travel.
It
blows my mind. This is supposed to be the replace. They don't even sell the CSR Elites anymore. They're my favorite for the price.
Can you swap out there's this foam in the middle of the space rubber spaces? Can you replace that with another rubber spacer, or does it have to be that?
It comes with three or four different hardness of rubber. They're like thick rubber washers, is what it is, and you can replace those. And I use the medium ones, and I use the hard ones. The hard ones are a little bit better, obviously, but yeah, you can swap those out and everything.
It sounds like you should just save up $100 more to get the V3.
Yes.
They're very, 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 very good. Very, very good.
Because with the V3s, the CSR Elites, you have four cables, four wires, two of them for the brake pedal, right? Because one for the load cell and one for the brake pedal itself, and then one for each other pedal. This is three wires for three pedals.
Do you?
I can't believe it.
I've never looked. Do you know, I've never actually looked. But why would you have one for the pedal and a load cell?
Because the load cell itself is like a mechanism. It's judging how hard you're pushing on it.
Exactly. So that's all you need.
But does your pedals have the vibrator for the brake?
No. I got a vibrator, so maybe that's why there's two going to mine. And I don't know. I've never really looked, actually.
And then the CSL wheel, the rim, it's like 100 and whatever bucks. And it's made for, like, Xbox, and it's light, smaller. It's got Xbox buttons on it. It's not horrible. I mean, you figure the Porsche rim, I mean, it's way cheaper than the Porsche rim. It's not bad. But I think the shining point is the base itself. For $300, it kicks ass, you know, for the price. But holy cow. But I'll try to make a full review of all the stuff, but... Yeah, it's ongoing review and testing, but I'm done with the pedals and I'm done with the rim. I'm just focusing today on the base itself.
It's kind of nice that they've given you so much time to really mess about with it properly, though, so at least you get a nice understanding and a decent review of it before you finally have to give it back, which is good.
Right.
Because you imagine having to go and review something for like 2 or 3 hours and then you wouldn't really have an awful lot of idea, would you?
Yeah, it's very true, but... Yeah, so that's the story on that. And that it's all available for pre-order right now, but I guess it doesn't ship until November. So, anybody interested?
I think it's still a quite interesting option because as you said in your review that it's like an option with the Thrustmaster wheels. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a very good price point for them, and also it's upgradable. So you can upgrade the wheel base later on to the Flop Sport wheel. You can change the rims, you can upgrade the pedals, because that's mostly what it's happening in the sim racing. Not so often people like buy all the high end stuff when you start iRacing or sim racing altogether.
Right.
You upgrade gradually.
Yeah, so exactly.
Really, Matt needs to get this wheel in the winter. Then he can really test it.
Yeah.
To see if he burns it out or not.
Well, I'm going to attempt the force feedback way up today.
Summertime's the worst time. Yeah, we'll Wintertime's the best time for you. Because you can kill it.
That's true.
See how stress-tested proper.
Yeah, that's very true. We'll do some Mazda drifting today with maximum force feedback. We'll see how the base handles. Hey, they told me I got to send it back. It doesn't mean I got to send it back in working order, you know? If it starts smoking out of the vents, you know, what are you going to do? Stress test it.
So far, with my experience, that the rims and the pedals from Fanatec, they are very, very good quality. I have no experience on the Club Sport wheel because I haven't had any of those. I haven't tested the wheel yet so far. But so far, hearing the feedback that there's quite many Club Sport wheel bases have been returned because they have broken down.
Yeah.
So.
The amount of people, Matt had trouble with his as well, didn't he? I know Bone Slippy had to send his back as well. The amount of people that have had problems with V2 bases is unbelievable. Hence the way we started calling Fanatec Fanafucked. But yeah, there seems to be people having problems all the time. Kind of glad I've never had the money to buy one, because I would be fucking devastated if I bought one of them and it was screwed after a little while, you know?
Yeah, Big Gunner sent me the link. Yeah, this is exactly what I got. And it says, the proprietary load cell is integrated directly into the pedal arm and measures the pressure on the pedal arm itself. It cannot be more direct. Dude, I seriously think that's like a lie, dude. Look, this is a pedal arm. It's right into the pedal shaft itself. Yeah, with a bunch of spacers. There's nothing there. It's literally just a piece of metal with spacers on it. And one wire coming out the back. This is it. I think this is like false advertisement, man. I'm telling you.
It's in the pedal arm, so that means it's in the arm of the actual pedal.
It's just a piece of metal. There's nothing coming out.
In the arm. The arm. Right. You've got the arm of the pedal. Right. You've got the shaft coming off. It's in there. I guess.
No, but you would. Picture it's not.
You have would to take need it at the end of the. Of the shaft.
Yeah.
If you go back to that thing, right? On the back of the brake pedal, there was like a little raised square with the F on it, so maybe you take that off and there's something in there. Because you've got to be able to change it.
Well, just like who's Ringo, yes, but it doesn't use a pentameter. It uses a pressure sensor.
Yeah, which is a load cell. That's what a load cell is. It tells the program how hard you're pressing it. It converts that into, you know, a maximum or a minimum.
Well, you know what you have to do, Matt. When you are doing the full review, you have to break it down.
Well, it doesn't feel anything like the CSR Elites. Like, it's, to me, it just feels like a glorified tennis ball, because it's just giving you pressure as you push down on it. And the more you push down on it, you can keep pushing down on it. That's what I'm saying. You can just push it all the way down. Dude.
Was there any?
It's a downgrade compared to CSR Elites.
Was there any kind of sensitivity setting on the drivers?
No.
Okay.
Not like you can do with the V3s, then.
Yeah.
I love that with the V3s. It's amazing, that is.
Yeah, so, they're good pedals. Again, you have two those too, Quirk.
Yep. Yeah, and they've been great. I've pretty much tried to destroy them. I probably have around 700 hours just in dirt with them. So I'm using all three pedals most of the time in dirt and, you know, like nonstop, lots and lots of shifts through just one stage. So,
have you broken a load cell yet?
Nope.
That was my biggest worry about getting them, because I remember, Bram either had V1s or V2s, one of the things, but he kept breaking load cells. He was going through them like candy. So I was a bit worried about that, but mine hasn't yet, thankfully.
Yeah, the only problem I had with my V3s is every once in a while, when I first got them, my throttle would stick about halfway. And I don't know what was causing that, but I haven't had that issue. And maybe it just had to get broken in. But,
there you go.
But that's it.
Well, I let my T500 pedals, so I've had them 4 years, nearly 5 years now, and they're still working. So, But I don't want to go to V3s for the simple fact is I still play like Euro Truck and American Truck. I don't know what they'd be like on that. I don't know if it'd still be fine. Good.
Yeah, they'd still be fine. It'd be better, actually. At least the brake pedal would feel more like a brake as well.
This one works all right.
I'll tell you
Mine
when
works
I went,
champion.
When no, I no, what I mean the... is, like, this brake now feels like an actual car brake.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah.
There's not much throw, and you really got to leather it to get it all in. But it's nice because you never do that with a real car anyway. You just, you know. But it makes a hell of a difference.
Going from the T500 pedals to the V3 pedals, with the T500 pedals, I felt like I had a guess where my throw was on the pedal. I couldn't really feel where it was in, you know, percentage-wise.
Did you run the conical mode?
I did not. I did
not. Obviously, I run the conical mode on mine, so...
Well, even on, like, just the gas and the clutch, I couldn't feel, like, percentage-wise. I would have to think and guess about how far I'm pushing the pedal. But then with, like, the V3 pedals, and I put the harder black spring on the throttle, and especially with the brake, I went from having to think about it to feeling it with my muscles.
Mm-hmm.
And that was pretty drastic of a change. And it blew me away that any percent on the throttle, I can just leave my foot there and it'll stay. You know, I don't have to, it's not going to move it. It's pretty great. So. Mm-hmm.
And the V3s are $300.
Yeah. For how bad you were saying the other pedals were, I would say. If somebody's going to try to buy that bundle, maybe they should go for the base. That's three, right? And the pedals are three.
Yeah.
So that's six, and then just whatever rim you want.
Right. Yeah, I think that'd be much better. Because pedals, dude, pedals are so important. You can't skimp out on the pedals, man. Like, you can skimp out maybe on the rim, get a good base, get good pedals. I think that's the way to go.
I would say also that the force feedback is not so important as the braking. Mm-hmm. Braking is the most important because the force feedback is just more immersion. And of course, it will give you a little bit more detail what the car is doing. But to be able to control the car is a lot better with the pedals than with the wheel.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yeah.
How is that in dirt rally? Like, what's more important in dirt rally? Is it the pedals? Like, as far because your feet are going crazy when you're doing that.
Yeah, you know, in rally, it almost seems like I would say that it probably doesn't matter as much in circuit or in rally as it does in circuit racing because in rally, you're pretty much full on and full off, like nonstop. You're not really thinking about trying to feather the throttle on a long sweeping high speed corner. You're just going left and right really fast, and that's about it. So, but I did notice the an increase in driving ability with the new pedals in rally and iRacing. It's being able to feel how much you're braking before a corner is just. I never thought about how much pedals affect your driving ability until you got ones that are pretty good.
Yeah.
So.
Now I notice you have the what do they call those? The pedal plates that are like curved a little
bit. D-shape.
The D-shape. You like those?
Shape. Yeah. I had I put those on. I tried the originals, the ones that came on there already, the metal flat ones, but. The D-shaped ones, they're just fine for heel toe. I wasn't too sure about it at first, but it's fine for heel toe, and it's nice because they're arced a little bit. So when you push down in the middle, your foot kind of slides down. So mm-hmm. So you can modulate your throttle a little bit more.
Yeah, we're just looking at the V3s right now on the website. Dude, they look badass.
they're really good.
They look awesome.
I still haven't put them second, the top ones, the top pedal faces on mine yet. I've still got the flat ones on.
You should try the Tilton pedals. And I also, one thing I love on the pedals is the pedal extensions, which give you more room for the ankle. So you can, like, if you are not able to adjust your ankle for the pedals, by itself, like if you have them flat on the ground or stuff like that, you can still adjust the angle with the pedal extensions.
Ooh.
So
that's very nice.
Yeah, I'm using the pedal extensions as well. Yeah, you can change the angle on these and the face plates and the resistance. It's great. You can even change the braking resistance in windows. So you can do modification. Well, not really modifications, but you can make some changes hardware wise and software wise with them. Hmm. For $100 more, I would go for these over those Elites. Yeah.
One thing I have been looking for these pedals is a little bit longer face plate. I think the face plate is a little bit too short. So I don't know if there's any custom face plates for that, which I could use.
Face plate? You mean where you rest your heel or the face plate on the pedal?
No, the heel rest.
That is kind of short. I don't know. You could probably get somebody to fabricate one. It looks like it's... I mean, when I've taken it off, it's just a piece of metal with a little bit of an angle to screw into those three holes. So
yeah.
But it is really short.
We are we'll probably be wrapping up soon. If you guys want to tweet a couple of questions our way at hashtag GripTV Live, we are joined with Quirkitized, the newest member to the GripTV family. If you go to GripTVteam.com, you can see the full list of streamers now with Quirkitized on there. Dirt Rally turned iRacer, but still does both, right? You still do both, obviously, right?
Yeah.
And a lot of iRacing. Alien Rally Driver, dude, I'm telling you.
Can I just say one thing?
It's fun to watch.
I want to see a big up to everyone who races in an office chair and a whale. Because I've recently just bought myself a GT Omega whale stand, because I bought another whale for my Xbox, which I've been using quite a bit. And that shit is hard, because I've had this rig for 5 years, so I've always been nice and stable. And on my Xbox, I've gone onto the whale stand, and I tell you what, the amount of times I've pressed my brake and my chair's gone like that.
How these people
manage it, I do not know. It is hard work.
Yeah,
so anyone out there who races like that, big up to you. Because I've just found out how tough that actually is. Because when I first started, before I bought this, I had a makeshift whale stand, but I had a chair without whales, and it was against the wall, so it wasn't so bad. But this is the first time office chair we're racing with whales on, and it's tough.
Take the wheels off or put casters on them. You could take the wheel casters off, can't you? And you could buy other ones, which is just
I could probably do that.
Look at Sam. It makes it more fun. He says he races on a wicker chair.
Yeah, Sam does. Sam races on a wicker chair.
Yeah, he does. A wicker. I set out all this wicker just for you.
It's definitely an eye opener.
Yeah.
You know, let's take the inside sim racing with a slip angle.
It's
your own sim experience stage 4 15 rounds.
Perfect. It's definitely an interesting experience. That's fun. We have nothing coming in on Twitter I can see.
Oh my gosh, unbelievable.
Come on, guys.
So what's the schedule for today, guys? I know JP already streamed. Check out his VOD for a hell of a GT3 race, man. That was incredible. I was watching that, and it's at Monza, so it's crazy with the chicanes. And then JP's like, stop hitting me. Stop hitting me. He's like, using my car to drive or something, you're saying.
Yeah, that's what I usually – well, I have found that that's nicer to say in the public chat and just say F off, fuck off. So that's my thing to say, that when someone's hitting me, I just yell to the radio, start driving with your own car, not mine.
Yeah. And what do you say if you hit the wall in your native language?
Perkele.
Is it that?
Perkele.
Oh my gosh. We're learning all sorts of new
things. It's quite an art form, actually. It's not many people who can roll their R's enough to say that word.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you got? Pontiac's going, man cave? When are you doing your next...
I don't know, because every time I've tried it this week, it's zero participation.
Dude. So yeah, I did a PCC race, and it was one solstice in like 20 Mazdas.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
I don't know why. I've been, actually this week, I've been hitting Forza pretty hard, ready for a new Horizon, which is coming out in the 28th of this month. But I've actually getting into a set of Corsa on PC.
Okay.
So I'm been hitting that pretty hard. Because I've had like 2 weeks where I haven't streamed. Just one, because I wasn't too keen on racing Bathurst. And participation this week for GTC has been terrible, so...
Yeah.
How do you like Assetto Corsa compared to iRacing for driving?
I'm pretty much how the feel is. I'm pretty much the same as you. I actually prefer to race AI than like being online.
Because when people ask me how I like Assetto Corsa compared to iRacing, I tell them that I think it feels really, really good. If the games were reversed, where we had to pay subscription to Assetto Corsa, and it had the same multiplayer system as iRacing, you know, basically if they were just flipped, I would be fine with paying for Assetto Corsa. I think it's a great, great game. It's just unfortunate. Nothing compares to iRacing's multiplayer.
Well, I've had a lot of mixed reports as far as console version, because I was actually going to buy it for the console as well, just to see what it was like. But apparently, there's some say it's brilliant, some say it's broken. Lots of stutters, which JP players would hate.
Yeah, JP has some stutter issues.
Yes.
Yeah.
But apparently, on the console version, there is pretty. It's pretty bad, like, apparently. So, but I will get it eventually.
So it should be. Console peasants shouldn't be allowed to have nice things.
Well, I'm actually going to do a video soon, because obviously I've got this as the PC Master Race, four screens, all of this, and then my little console set up right next to it, which is just a TX with the T3PA pedals and tiny little rig. That's it. With my death chair.
Yeah.
Airmessy, got a nice new 27 monitor for it. So.
What can we expect from an Airmessy stream besides domestic abuse?
I don't think I'm going to stream today. Like, tonight is the bloody, because the Sunday nighters are doing Formula One now, and we're doing a full season.
Yeah.
But tonight is practice night for Bahrain, and I can't stream the game unless I turn all the graphics right down to the lowest point.
Oh.
Because it just looks like shite on the stream otherwise.
Right.
So. Don't think, unless I don't do that and I go on iRacing, but I don't know, I'm definitely going to be streaming tomorrow anyway. I'm going to go and pick up bits and pieces tomorrow, but tomorrow night I'll be streaming.
Is there a way to, as you're running F1 2016, to be able to record it locally?
And then probably through YouTube. OBS. Yeah, I was thinking about doing that.
Yeah.
But I don't know how big it's going to be, that's the trouble, and I haven't got a massive amount of hard drive space, so I don't know.
Yeah.
And it would mean, I would probably have to take Formula One from the second hard drive and put it on my SSD, which probably doesn't even have enough room for it. I don't know. Yeah. There'll be a workaround some way. I'll fix it somehow, but it's just a pain in the ass, in all honesty.
Yeah. And when is Corkitized next stream going to be? The first GripTV debut stream?
Probably sometime this evening. I'm not sure how many hours from now, but I did stream for a few hours this morning, I don't know. It'll probably be F1 2016 Dirt Rally or iRacing, one of the three.
Very nice.
It's usually always a racing stream, and every once in a while it'll be something randomly different.
Okay.
But yeah, most of the time Dirt Rally or iRacing.
Yep. And, I'm going to be testing out this new base here soon, so be on the lookout for that. Quirkitize, guys. If you haven't given him a follow, give him a follow. Go to griptvteam.com and see the full list of streamers. He's now on there.
Hi, guys.
Part of the family. Oh, man. It's going to be
great. Very own Carl Pilkington.
We're all going to get together and snuggle.
Oh, yay.
Don't forget, I'm back streaming again, so give me some
That's
love
right.
For him. I need to build my numbers back up.
Man Cave Racing TV. There he is, folks. And Jay plays Airmessy Corkitize. I'm Showdown. This has been another GripTV Hangout. If you guys missed any GripTV Hangouts, go to the YouTube down below. Click on the link. You can see not only the GripTV Hangouts, which last time we had Sean Cole. And don't forget, we do a broadcast. There's going to be a broadcast this Friday for the next Friday. No, next Friday is week 13. What am I talking about? Next season, new Lotus, all that good stuff with Jess Brony. Check it all out, guys. We love you. Have a good one. Bye-bye now. Bye-bye. Bye-bye now.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.